Good evening, this is Ramon again. It's still January 8th, 2017, 11:10 Eastern Time. And it's, for me, it's a Super Bowl, or at least for the Bold Like a Leopard page, or at least for me as a writer on that page, which I started. I'm talking about my Obamacare, or my Obama administration wrap-up. You see, I'm sounding a little eager there, because I got to the topic that I wanted to talk about the most. And for a lot of people, it was boring for years and years. They didn't want to talk about Obamacare, what it really meant. They wanted to say, oh, it's big government taking over healthcare. Kind of, and kind of not. It was a decoy. And I'm going to try to run through it. And I always run long. I apologize if my videos are long. But a lot of these subjects, you can just keep going and going on them. And you know, you could probably find even deeper discourses in this type of material. So why do I think that Obamacare is, you know, the Super Bowl of what it is that I do on this opinion page and on my opinion blogs? Look, in 2008, I didn't vote. I didn't vote in 2004. I wasn't impressed by Barack Obama. I wasn't impressed by George Bush. I wasn't impressed by Hillary Clinton. I wasn't impressed by John McCain. I was impressed by, but not enough to vote for him and his policies for sure. They didn't seem to really depart from anything that other presidents already had attempted. And what happened was that it was created. I kind of was not in the loop, was not living in the U.S. at the time. And I wasn't really the type of person that really liked to go out and vote and be active in politics. I'd kind of been disillusioned in it. And what happened was that President Obama had inspired a lot of other Americans who were living here, who were very desperate for a change of attitude and at least a change of the face of the Republic of the United States of America. He was that great hope that they were looking for. And I can say for sure, just letting you look at it, you should always get a look at my outfit. You know, who knows, maybe one day, you know, I'll probably be wearing some sort of shower curtain underneath here. So I'm wearing the wolf shirt today. You know, I always think it's weird when people just show their head during a video, like you don't know what the fuck's going on in the background. And in the over here, you got a little puzzle that has always been here. So we're getting all that other stuff out of the way. I'm going to talk mostly about Obamacare today. I don't think that I'm going to add any other topics, even the NFL. We're just going to talk through the ACA. Originally in 2008, like I said, he inspired so many people by getting elected. I did not vote at all. So I did not oppose Barack Obama. I didn't vote for Barack Obama. I didn't vote for Hillary Clinton in the primary. I didn't vote for McCain in the general election. I didn't vote for anybody. I was not active. But a lot of people were voting for the first time. And there was a good amount of momentum that was driving him to overhaul the healthcare system. And in the eyes of many committed liberals, that was explicitly to create either universal healthcare or the public option. And what that means is that, as opposed to only having private insurance or Medicaid or Medicare or the VA, or employer health plans, there would be government-run healthcare insurance for the average citizen. And that would be either the public option, which would mean that the government would be competing with the private market. That's the basic gist of it. I think, you know, if you have more information on it, go ahead, comment me, tell me where I'm wrong, but I'm just giving a small summary. The public option is where it would be competing with those things, the universal healthcare system would possibly displace private insurance entirely, and you would only have healthcare being distributed by the government as a right. And this has become more familiar since 2015, when Bernie Sanders entered the race for president for the 2016 election. It became more of a rallying cry among people who were disappointed with private insurance in general. So why is it that in 2008 this was a big idea and it never got implemented? As opposed to, that this is that in 2008 he gets elected, 2016 it's still an issue. 2016 there's still a lot of people in the Democratic Party and beyond the Democratic Party to the left of it that think a public option is the way to go, but they didn't get it under Obama. Why did that happen? Well, as I discuss in my article, Obama Wrap-Up Part 2, it's a blog post, in Sickness and in Health, which I just published a few minutes ago, I kind of briefly go through most of the stages of Obamacare, and it's so long of an issue that I couldn't publish it all today. And you could look at my opinion page. There's tons of other descriptions of various stages of Obamacare, especially the last few years. But it's really something that people could write books about. And what happened was that originally he did have the public option and universal health care, or rather, the public option was his compromise, and universal health care was something that he probably aspired to later. And during his campaign, he wanted to implement that, and he quickly discovered that the Democratic Party and the insurance companies and the pharmaceutical industries and the Republicans, they do work hand in hand, and the hospital lobby. Let me point that out. And according to some articles, and I linked to them in my blog. It's at struttingleopard.blogspot.com. It will be the first post as of right now, and I'll put a link to it. But according to the New York Times, he did cut a deal through his chief of staff, Jim Messina, one of his Chicago imports, to throw away the public option in exchange for the insurance industry backing whatever plan he wanted, or rather the hospital lobby. So the hospital lobby's basic incentive is that they want to keep healthcare costs at a relatively high rate in order to boost their revenues, because most hospitals in the United States, if you're talking about at least the elite hospitals like Cedars-Sinai, the Cleveland Clinic, the Mayo Clinic, you could talk about St. Jude's. They are run by private foundations. They may be nonprofit, but they're not. Nonprofit is basically a different way of saying, we're not a corporation, but we still have to pay the bills. So they say it's nonprofit, but somebody's still reaping the revenues. So the hospital lobby did cut a deal with him, according to the Huffington Post, and I think his name is Miles Michelescu, some Romanian name. I might not have the article anymore. Here we go. His name is Miles Mogulescu, and he claimed that in 2009 already, Obama had pitched the public option to the dirt. And he came up with this Frankenstein format, which was subsidized private insurance. Now I'm gonna pause here for a second, because what I have to say is that you should understand this point. I will never support, and I never have supported, public health care for free, because I know it's an illusion, okay? But I will say this, and I'll concede this to the burnouts that are out there. what Obama did end up passing was far worse and was possibly much more abusive than the public option would have been, because the public option, at least you would have some consistency. You would know that you have an address to direct your problems to. With the ACA, he created this human centipede, like in the movie. I didn't see the movie, but it's basically the insurance industry was not forced, but they were co-opted into giving their subsidized programs, their subsidized insurance policies, through some insurance exchanges, and then they would sell it to individuals and households within certain income brackets. And that's what became the Patient Protection Affordable Care Act, the ACA usually it's called for short. Obamacare is what it was called. And immediately, despite the fact that people didn't understand it, despite the fact that its length in terms of pages is a matter of dispute. Most people agree that it's over 10,000 pages, by the way, and they haven't read it. And there was a famous scene on the press conference with Nancy Pelosi where she said they have to pass the bill in order to read it, in order to know what's in it. That was a harbinger of what their attitude would be, that how dare you, you fucking racist redneck from Kentucky, let's say, how dare you object to this? You're not smart enough to really know what's in this. Never mind the fact that they don't read it. Never mind the fact that it has nothing to do with race. We're talking about an industry that could use a lot of reform. It could use a lot of reform today, and it could have used a lot of reform in 2009. What it really did, it did not reform the industry. What it did was it created these exchanges in these states, Oregon, Nebraska, Kansas. I think slightly less than half the states had exchanges at one time. And what Obamacare did was it set up subsidized healthcare exchanges across the states, and there was a federal exchange, healthcare.gov. And what happened was that these subsidized plans soon they did get enrollment from a large number of people that could not afford insurance under private insurance plans prior to the Affordable Care Act, or they were being denied coverage due to pre-existing conditions. Now, a number of the promises made due to Obamacare were these. I'm going to try to list as many of them as I can. If I miss one, too bad. We're still trying to do this on video, and I'm using the article as notes. Okay, number one was to lower the cost of healthcare premiums and deductibles. Number two was to guarantee coverage for all, meaning that you could not deny coverage due to pre-existing conditions. Number three was to increase competition in the market, which was one of the that goal was in order to help reduce the price of healthcare premiums. And there were a number of other promises. So let's see, what did I hit? It required all citizens. That's another one. The individual mandate was sort of what had happened with car insurance probably in the late 90s. Most states now require all drivers to hold auto insurance on their car, at least to have a policy. Even if you're driving your parents' car, it has to be insured. It's illegal to drive without insurance. This bill would fine you if you did not have health insurance. It's slightly different. It's not a crime. It's not a prosecutorial crime in the civil code, but you do get fined, and that's a tax. And the individual mandate would be something that Obama was going to use to encourage people in whatever way possible to enter some type of insurance plan so that there would be fewer uninsured claims in hospitals that would be forced to be covered by the federal government. And that was thought to be a good way to reduce just unplanned spending on medical and healthcare costs by the federal government. But what actually happened was that he promised certain things that could not be fulfilled. The most famous one was where he declared on several occasions, and I posted a link, I linked to it in my blog. He claimed that if you like your plan, you can keep it. If you like your physician, you can keep that. By 2014, that was revealed to have been a lie. It was even called the lie of the year, I believe, by PolitiFact, which is a wonder since they usually don't directly attack the president, at least not this president. And what happened was that by this time, Obama had solidified a relationship where the press didn't really know how to approach criticism of him, because political figures had to step out there and crowd the plate, so to speak, when they were going up against him. This Joe Wilson, for example, I did put him in there. He yelled out that Obama had lied about the ACA being directed to cover illegal immigrants. In the end, according to the Fiscal Times in 2015, February 2015, there were something like 200,000 undocumented people, not to say that they were all illegal aliens, but they had no documentation, that had to be booted from Obamacare, or that they were being planned to get booted from Obamacare, and they'd already been covered for about a year. And then during the 2016 election season in California, there was an idea pitched by a number of California state legislators to extend Obamacare eligibility to illegal aliens in that state. So this really was just a package of lies at every level. And the lies were not just in the fact that he promised things that he knew he could not deliver, such as that you could keep your plan and your physician. Those things he couldn't guarantee, because a physician, A, could decide, I'm not going to be covered by such and such insurance if they're not capable of paying out their claim. And B, the plan could actually be eliminated by the insurance company should they decide that it was not earning them much money. If a person was claiming if the person was filing too many claims, the insurance company would, you know, just like in real life, just like anywhere else, if you keep filing claims, you will lose your insurance. It's an unfortunate fact when we're talking about healthcare, but it happens. And that's one of the huge flaws of Obamacare. And I think you can find a consensus on that among both conservatives and progressives, and especially among insurance professionals, insurance salespeople, insurance adjusters, things like that. You don't want people with high claims, otherwise you really do have to charge them high premiums. It's a basic rule of the insurance industry, and it's something that it shows just the arrogance of the president and of his staff, and of his political spin doctors, that they thought that they could overcome a basic rule of an industry, a financial industry. You know, insurance is not, it's not like you're selling rutabagas or something. You're really selling trust in a policy. And I'm not an expert on it by any chance. That's why I referred in the article to Charles Gaba, who does happen to be a huge nerd when it comes to every single statistic concerning Obamacare. And he happens to be a public option advocate. So you can't say that I'm just like fucking showing up for whatever his name is, Paul Ryan, you know, the House Speaker. Obamacare was a Frankenstein monster, and there were other issues, and I'm going to keep going in the sequence. It did not actually come into effect for real until January of 2014. So Obama kind of cheated in a way. He had it signed in 2010, and I think him and both him and the Republicans, they were playing it in a way coyly, where they bet that on the one hand, Obama said, well, I'm not going to let this ruin my reelection chances in 2012. I think he did have a point where he didn't want it to be instituted too quickly, but he did not want it to cloud his reelection campaign in 2012. And the Republicans thought, we don't want this to be necessarily our, we don't want this to cloud our campaign. And they thought they could defeat him before the ACA would be implemented, which was a huge mistake. And they were using all their legislative shenanigans the whole time to try to repeal it, which wouldn't work. I mean, you need the president to repeal it. So you better win that race. You better win in 2012. What did they do? They were nominated Mitt Romney. What a joke. So what happened in 2014? You did get to see the ACA. It never became that what-if scenario. If Mitt Romney had been elected president, it's a good question whether he would have actually signed legislation that would have repealed the ACA, or if it would have actually reached his desk, because the Democrats perhaps would have retained control of the Senate. So you might have had the Affordable Care Act under a Republican president rolled out. So who's to say? That's why you can never trust these GOP people. Because they don't know, you can't trust people that are, they'll promise something that they themselves will basically shield themselves from. And that's what they do. That's what the GOP, they've allowed such retarded policies to just crawl under their fence for years and years. That's the way it is. That's why you shouldn't trust either political party. You should just trust your own critical thinking abilities to decide what's bullshit and what's not bullshit. So in 2014, it did get implemented under the reelected president, Barack Obama. And the rollout was so poorly managed, and especially the webpage, healthcare.gov, that it led to the resignation of a cabinet member, Health and Human Services Secretary Kathleen Sebelius. I think that was in April of 2014. And it was not long after that that we really got to see how dismally this whole policy had been administered and planned and built, the actual infrastructure. Because remember, we're talking about roughly 23 state exchanges that were formed using state money. So you basically had to open up new state companies in every state, and usually for a price tag of in the hundreds of millions of dollars of public money in your state taxes. I believe some of them had to take loans from the federal government or something. I'm not sure exactly how they financed it, because some of these states, they were in debt anyway. California's been in debt for decades. So they roll out Obamacare, and these exchanges start to fall like a house of cards, each one, or just a row of dominoes. You had Oregon, you had Tennessee, I believe their exchange fell. Illinois for sure. Illinois was the most well-publicized case because that was a state where, you know, this was the president's home turf. And the fact is that the same problems that were endemic of Obamacare across the country, which is that you're enrolling high-risk patients for policies that are below market price, it was basically a recipe for failure. This is price fixing and nothing less. It's not giving people better access to healthcare. It's just saying you can buy within this range, and we'll approve it every year. And the insurance companies, you know, they get the money to supplement whatever they're losing on that policy. And that's how we're going to improve access. That doesn't really mean anything, because in the end, as you found out, the insurance companies could still raise the rates if the state would approve their rate raises. And the state had to accommodate them for the very simple reason that, first of all, the health care exchanges were falling apart. So you did not, there were certain companies that had been formed, insurance companies that were formed to offer policies on these state exchanges only for those states under the ACA. And once the exchange fell because of lack of enrollment or because of high claims traffic, those companies just went belly up. So that competition that Obama had promised evaporated. It was a mirage. Then whatever was left in that exchange or whatever was left in that state on the federal exchange, because now the patients have to go as, so to speak, and this was called in a number of these articles, they were called Obamacare ACA refugees from the state exchanges. They had to migrate to the federal exchange where there's even fewer companies, and usually they were some of the insurance giants like Aetna, Blue Cross, Blue Shield. Specifically in Arizona, there were areas where there was only one option, Blue Cross Blue Shield of Arizona. There was United Healthcare. So they started getting overflowed by these claims by people or these new enrollees in the middle of the year of people that were still high-risk policyholders. So then what happens to those people? You're going to get, it was sort of set up so that the exchanges fell first, and then the insurance companies were already taking losses from a lot of these patients, and they said, you know, fuck you, we're done with this policy, we don't even need it, we're not earning any money. Even if they were earning money, they weren't going to admit it. And they outfoxed Obama, and it was one of the most classic moments of political ineptitude. And I did discuss this in a couple other posts. I don't think I discussed it in this blog article that I made. But what happened was that Obama was trying to he basically made a deal with the devil, if you're going to call the insurance companies the devil, which a lot of people think they would be. He said, you know, I'm going to include this. I'm going to include you on this, and I guarantee you will make money. The insurance company said, if we do this, this is a great idea. Think about it. They faked their way into this ACA. They were able to get, in some cases, subsidies for their phony baloney insurance plans. Often, in some cases, the deductibles became so high that people didn't even want to go and seek medical treatment towards the end. And even now, people are not using their Obamacare policies to file claims because the deductibles are so high. They have to pay so much money. They're paying, in some cases, $15,000 out of pocket. I mean, what kind of shit is that? That was a fantasy when I was a kid. Who would have ever thought that you would pay $15,000 for a hospitalization? You know, I mean, I guess there's exceptions. You know, it depends what people get. But the insurance companies were able to, and Obama was going along with it the whole time. He was saying, well, we just have to show that the premiums are going down. Well, eventually that didn't even work either. You were getting a low premium at the beginning with a high deductible. In the end, they couldn't justify even that because there were so many claims from the pre-existing condition people that at some point they had to make the money back elsewhere in order to satisfy their stockholders. I do believe that in some way the insurance companies, and I'm not sure, I'm not an expert on how these you know, these games work, but I do believe they made some sort of money off of it. I just know that they found a way to hide it. And that's the beauty of how, you know, you have this arrogant prick, Obama, coming in and pretending that he's wiser than others. And all these insurance company sharks and crocodiles just ate him for lunch, or at least ate his supporters for lunch, because they thought that it would work. They didn't understand the basic rules of the industry, which are rules that a lot of us should probably learn. I had to learn it through the process too. There's probably a few issues there that we could all round out more, but why take the policy area, Obama? Why do you take the policy area that involves so much complication, so much paperwork, so much regulation, and you make that the landmark of your presidency, that was a huge fucking mistake. And that gets to what happened through 2015, 2016. You had skyrocketing premiums already in November 2015, which was a year before the election. I remember that Trump was claiming that there were double-digit premium increases in Obamacare. Of course, the political what would you call them? They're his shield. They're like his mama eagle. They shielded Obama from all the criticism, saying, "Oh, it wasn't. No, there's no double-digit increases." Well, fuck you. There really were. And in 2015, not this year. In 2015, rolling into 2016, insurance premiums under Obamacare for the silver plans increased by 25% in Colorado. They increased by also similar numbers in West Virginia and North Carolina. I think it was like, I can't see the graphic, but it's 38% in Tennessee. That was in 2015. Do you want to know what happened in 2016 going into this year, 2017? Tennessee, 63% increase. Minnesota, 59% increase. Oklahoma, 69% increase. This is all weighted averages. And Arizona, 116%. So in some of these states, which, by the way, he was trying to win an election in, or he was trying to get Hillary to win an election. And from what I could tell, he was sincere in trying to get her to win. Barack Obama, his main policy sticking point, Obamacare. You were seeing people have their premiums go from $300 a month to something like $550. Would you accept your cable bill jumping like that? Would you accept your heating bill jumping like that? That would be a national scandal. So I'm tired of these apologists who talk about, oh, he tried and he meant well and he really had our backs. Let me go through some of the, and I've already gone through all the sequence of Obamacare from birth, from cradle to we're getting to the grave. There's only one point that I did neglect to point out, that it passed on that it passed the House on a split Democratic line. There were 34 Democrats that voted against Obamacare. The majority of them got plowed over in the 2010 election for the House because they were blue dog Democrats. Those are seats that I think in the majority of cases the Democratic Party might never win again, at least not without some sort of alliance with some sort of local group or something, with some sort of conservative group. There is no way that in some of these areas, in Indiana or in Kansas, they're not coming back. Not unless there's scandals or individual cases where somebody dies or something. You're talking about irretrievably poisoned wells for the Democrats. That's what the ACA did. It destroyed the blue dog Democrat. It destroyed the centrist Democrat. And Obama doesn't care because he believed those people were expendable. Well, those seats are not going to be coming back. You're going to have to accept that these Obamacare sacrificial lambs are irrecoverable. And that's what I'm getting to. Because we've gone through the sequence of how it was passed, what the considerations were, why Obama abandoned the public option and the universal health care configuration, which goes without saying, if you're abandoning the public option, you're also abandoning universal health care. And we talked about the structure and the broken promises and everything. And what I want to say is that despite all the rhetoric about Obamacare and you know that how it was a divisive topic, I think it actually was not talked about enough. Because this is a president that came to power came into office in 2008. I mean, came to power, whatever. Let's say he came to power. He had both houses of Congress in his hands. And this was the linchpin of the great squandering. That's what I call his presidency. Obama's great squandering is taking a policy point, which was possibly the greatest blunder in history, health insurance. And within 2 years, he lost governorships to the Republicans. He lost the House to the Republicans. And these weren't very inspiring Republicans, by the way. The Republican Party was also dropped the ball on health care. They've never offered an alternative. I mean, you should be listening to me too, Republicans. We've never, as opponents of Obamacare, we've never seen the Republican Party offer an alternative. Some of the policies that Donald Trump advocated for in this election, I mean, maybe I was missing something, but maybe he just marketed it better than you. Him saying that we're going to eliminate the lines between the states and let insurance companies compete on a national basis, you know, maybe you should have just pitched it better. Maybe you should take a lesson from this. I mean, you can call him a buffoon, but people know that they need something that's different from what they have today. And he pitched it in a way that they could digest it. And you didn't, Paul Ryan, Mitt Romney, you didn't do it. You had something very simple. You just have to provide an alternative to Obamacare, and you didn't do it. And apparently he did. Is he going to implement it? I don't know. I think he might fail at it. This is one of the most difficult policy areas to succeed at: insurance law and insurance regulations and healthcare. I don't know if he's going to succeed. I don't even know if I trust him, but I know sure as hell that I don't trust the Republicans in Congress, and I don't trust the Democrats in Congress. I think we're up Schitt's Creek with both of these parties after what we've seen throughout the Obama years. And you allowed Obamacare to pass. So we're gonna wrap up soon. And I just want to say this. What we saw for 8 years, we saw a president that he promised a lot of things, and he delivered one thing, and it turned out to be a complete and just blatant lie. It was a policy that did not cater to even his best supporters, the progressive left, because it was not universal health care. It was a policy that neglected a sector of the American population, the lower income, the minority voter, the minority communities, you know, Hispanics and African Americans. Native born, I'm talking about the ones that live in low income housing. They were also asking for better health care. And what Obamacare did, it didn't satisfy any of these people because it didn't give them the public option for the people that believe in that. For the people that don't believe in that, it created this fixed pricing that made their lives a nightmare. So whether you're for the public option or you're against the public option, Obamacare was a complete, I keep saying the word complete, I just started noticing that. Obamacare was sort of a shit sandwich for everybody. You know, sorry to rephrase it that way, but if you are a capitalist or if you're a socialist, it just doesn't work. It's crony capitalism. Neither side likes it. If you're a low-income voter, a low-income community member, somebody who was disenfranchised by the insurance system prior to Obamacare, it didn't make a lick of difference. Because in order to really be able to be affected directly by Obamacare, you had to be making a certain amount of income. Now, if you remained unemployed throughout Obama's term or off the books, you were making money off the table, Obamacare was largely irrelevant to you because technically, you could probably be living on Medicaid and Medicare. Now, he did do the Medicaid expansion. So, for some of those people, that was a positive thing, but the quality of care did not improve for Medicaid. That was one of the other hopes that in general, the quality of care would improve. Now, the other problem is if you have more people getting on Medicaid, that's actually money that the federal government is shelling out, literally. And it's a real problem. I think we have to, we just have to, for people that are in the job market, it's really a problem now to find an employer that offers that insurance policy to get off Medicaid. And I'm not knocking anybody that's on Medicaid. I'm just saying that you cannot have this swelling of the ranks of the Medicaid subscribers. It's just, at some point the system is gonna crash and we're all gonna suffer for it. And we should just try to find a way. And I think Trump's policy on healthcare, that might be the only way to solve it. It's sort of depressing that we have this unknown. We have sort of a fire extinguisher that we're opening, and we don't even know if it's charged. That's the Trump plan. So we're just gonna have to wait and see. That's why this video, I can't dedicate a video to what's gonna happen with healthcare, because I really don't know. And I'm not gonna pretend to know. I'm not gonna pretend that it's better than what we have now, because I have no clue. And when I do know more, I'll probably try to do a longer assessment of that as well. And if Trump fails at it, I think this could be like the giant killer, healthcare. That it really harmed President Clinton, if you think about it. His term was also clouded by Hillary care and the failure of her to pass that policy and to get people on board with that policy. President Bush's term was also clouded by the people with pre-existing conditions. They couldn't get health care. So we're talking about a president that he picked a policy that inexplicably it led to him losing control of the legislative branch. He was crippled for all of his domestic legislative agenda for the rest of his term. So after 2010, Obama was incapable of passing his legislative agenda. That's why so many of his executive orders were necessary from his standpoint. He couldn't get any of these decisions passed otherwise. And he was governing as a sort of autocrat. And it ruined his foreign policy agenda as well, because at every step, you could get a majority in the House that would say, no, we're not going to go with you on Benghazi. We're not going to go with you on going and using force in Syria. We're not going to go with you on your policy in Israel. We're not going to go with you on your policies on energy, on oil drilling, on fracking. And for him to have picked, I think he took that gamble, and in 2010 he realized he really fucked up. And in 2012, he didn't get it back. He may have been reelected, but he was reelected to the same problem. And in 2014, given the results of that rollout of Obamacare from January to April, it just solidified that problem. He lost the Senate in 2014. And they were under the illusion the whole time since 2010, they were under the illusion that they would be able to regain at some point control of the other house in Congress, or both houses of Congress since 2014. They believed in 2016 that they would regain control of the Senate and retain control of the presidency. There was even talk of winning back control of the House. And the only reason I believe that Obama was unable to really accomplish any of those things was because of his colossal failure with Obamacare. It just put in the minds of people this perception that he could not get shit right. You know, he's a nice person. He can go on TV, charm the fucking boots off anybody. But when it comes down to actually providing the solution, there were many people, I think, that after Obamacare either did not vote at all or voted for somebody that was opposed to him. I think a lot of the progressives that voted for Stein were motivated to do that because of Obamacare, maybe also because of his foreign policy. I think a lot of the people that voted for Johnson were not libertarians. They were motivated because of Obamacare. I believe a lot of the people that voted for Romney in 2012 and for Trump in 2016 Obamacare, I call it the Waterloo version 2015. You know, 2016 it was the election, but the policy began to really it started to slide into the quicksand in 2015 with the premiums going up. The insurance companies were starting to realize that they were going to garner losses, and it was this clusterfuck that it was irreversible. There was no way that you could shine up that turd and make it look like a piece of shit, Mr. Obama. And for you to walk around and say, oh, and what was it in October? If you don't vote for Hillary Clinton, I'll take it as a personal insult to my legacy. He said that to a room of, I think it was the NAACP. Look, you fucked millions of American middle class people while simultaneously your Obamacare didn't do shit for your own communities. The people of Chicago are none the richer because of Obamacare. It's changed nothing for them. There's hardly anybody in your communities that you organized for prior to becoming president that was positively affected by Obamacare. And I hope that he realizes that when he moves into his new digs in Washington, D.C., because he's not really going to be living in Chicago that much. Because there's nothing, what is he going to be doing there? I mean, I want to ask him, you know, what did you do for the city that you promised so much for? I don't give a fuck about any of those other interests that they say, oh, Obama fucked us, whatever, you know. You have all these these Arab countries are saying, oh, Obama, he's a fucking asshole. He's bombing us. Yeah, because he's the president of the United States. A lot of the presidents of the United States bomb the fuck out of your countries. You got the Russians saying, oh, Obama, a fucking asshole. He's like accusing us of everything. Yeah, because he has no backbone. He can't take responsibility for everything. You got the Israelis saying, oh, Obama fucked us. Listen, you knew, any of you who complained, you knew he fucking hated you. He hates the shit out of you. Look, don't pussyfoot around this. You knew that this person did not have your best interests in mind. That's why Obamacare, Mr. President, that was your betrayal of everybody. Not anything, some of the other things you did were pretty retarded too. They were skeevy and they were sleazy, and you deserve criticism, and you'll get that criticism too. But Obama, this is, for me, the Super Bowl of whatever it is I do. I don't think it's that important. You know, I don't think a lot of people watch what I do. But when you talk about people that already had a hard time and they just get fucked completely over, and they open up that envelope and they see 116% premium increase if you're living in Arizona, I mean, how are you supposed to explain away, you know, your whole just this cornucopia that you were promising, this embarrassment of riches that you were saying, oh, you're gonna, yeah, people can keep their physician, people can keep their plan. When you promise something and then you don't deliver shit, and then average people end up having their lives ruined and they can't get the health care that they need, you deserve nothing but the contempt of everybody. And your fucking celebrity parties in the White House, while people are struggling to even comprehend what is going to happen next with their health care, that shows just how much you have respect for your own people. You're the people of Chicago, the people of you know, middle class America, the people of lower class America, the Black American people. You don't give a fuck about any of those people. And I don't care who still likes you. There's these people that they go around, they're saying, you know, they want Michelle to be president. What the fuck did she do for you? Can you tell me that she's always saying, oh, she gave that Barack gave people hope. Barack Obama gave people hope. What did he give them now? 116% increase in premiums. That's what he gave the Arizona people. That's what he gave what do I have here? Minnesota, 59% increase. That's what you get, you fucking idiots up there. That you did end up voting for Hillary Clinton. You were voting for more. You like it when people fuck with your insurance. I don't care anymore about being diplomatic about it. The President of the United States, after 8 years, he had one policy that he staked his entire legacy on, and it was atomic hydrogen cobalt bomb. Every fucking explosive you could throw, that it was the bomb of all bombs. It was Howard the Duck meets what's that other movie? Cutthroat Island meets Battlefield Earth. That's how big of a fucking bomb Obamacare was. And don't ever tell me that was a race. If you think that it's racist to say Obamacare was a failure, I want you to open your fucking insurance bill and tell me you want to pay 116% more next year compared to what you pay this year. And you tell me how racist you're going to feel after that. And that's all I have to say tonight. Have a great week, everybody. And we're going to have more episodes of this crap. And you're all going to hate me more, or you're going to like when I say more. I don't know. I mean, you might be thinking, oh, fuck this bold leopard dude. You know, what the fuck did he lives in this house with wooden blinds and whatever. What the fuck does he know? He doesn't even work in insurance, never even been in politics. You open your fucking insurance bill, and then you remember the bold leopard dude, and you tell me, do you feel any better about me being an asshole, an idiot, not knowing shit, because you voted for a guy who for 8 years didn't do shit for you, and we'll see you around the bend, and is bold like a leopard. Bold like a leopard on Facebook, bold in all caps. Strunningleopard.blogspot.com, and have a great week, and we'll be talking to you soon.